Welcome to the third video in this series. The purpose of the series is for me to create a realistic 3D model of a helicopter with functioning components with the intent of using that for future videos where I can explain and animate helicopter principles of operation. I'm doing this as an incremental build so I can use viewer comments to make this into a better product. At the end of the second video, I left you with the helicopter that you see on the screen now. In today's video, I've added the rotating and non-rotating swash plates. I refined the rotor control geometry to accept the control inputs from the rotating swash plate. I adjusted the location of the spindle to allow for all of the rotor degrees of freedom. I added the two engines, but only the rotating components of the engines, not the stators or the engine cases. Remaining work for future videos is to add and rig the rotor pitch links, dampers, and scissors, and the tail rotor hub, tail rotor blades, and the tail rotor controls. As with the last video, I'm going to do this video in three parts. For part one, I'll talk about a few topics on the theory of operation of a helicopter. In part two, I'll cover computer-aided design techniques and considerations. And in part three, I'll cover some animation techniques. I'll cover three topics in the theory of operation of a helicopter. I'll talk about the rotation speeds of the two sections of the engine. Then I'll talk about how it's possible to start helicopter engines without spinning the rotor blades. And the final topic I'll cover will be how a helicopter auto-rotates, specifically how it disengages the engines in order to allow auto-rotation. The color scheme for the main gearbox that's on the screen right here, this is left over from the second video in this series where I talked about the different rotation speeds of the various components inside the main gearbox. I'm continuing that color scheme now with the two parts of the engines. The gas generator portion of the engine, this is the part that's colored in teal. This rotates at 45,000 RPM. And the power section of the engine, this is the part colored in purple, turns at 21,000 RPM. And these are actual numbers. These come from the data sheet for the UH-60 Black Hawk helicopter powered with T-700 engines. But the engines in the animation, they're clearly not turning at 45,000 and 21,000 RPM. I had to slow them down to make them visually realistic on the screen. Otherwise, it just would be a blur in the animation. With the engines operating this slowly, this helps to illustrate just how dramatic that gear reduction is to go from 21,000 at the power section of the engine to 258 RPM at the main rotor. If I zoom in on these bolts on the swash plates, you can just start to see the rotation of the main rotor. To put this in perspective, in real life it would take about a quarter of a second for a complete rotation of the main rotor. What you're looking at here with the playback slowed as much as it is would take 12 minutes for one revolution. This next topic that I want to talk about, and again this comes from viewer comments to earlier videos, is to answer the question of how a helicopter pilot starts the engines of the helicopter without spinning the rotors. The really short answer is that there's a thing called a rotor brake, and this holds the blade stationary while the engines are running, but let's dive into this in a little bit more detail. In one of those earlier videos, I didn't do a very good job of showing the two key parts of gas turbine engines, so I'm going to use colors here to show the difference between the gas generator section and the power section. The teal colored assembly is the gas generator. The purple colored assembly is called the power section of the engine. The gas generator is, by all rights, an engine in and of itself, even without the power section. I'll hide the power section and show only the gas generator. The entire gas turbine cycle takes place in the gas generator. Intake, compression, combustion, power, and exhaust. The turbine wheels on this part of the engine, they have one purpose. They extract energy from the gas flow in order to power the compressor portion of the cycle. This becomes a self-sustaining gas turbine cycle. And about 75% of the energy produced by the entire engine is used by the gas generator just to sustain this cycle. So far, none of this energy is sent to the main rotor. Now I'll add the power section back in. The purple colored part is called the power section. This is the part that transmits power to the rotors. And it consists of power turbine wheels that extract the leftover energy from the flow of hot exhaust gas from the gas generator, and a shaft that transmits this power to the helicopter's drive system. The power section isn't connected to the gas generator spool. Instead, it's a shaft within a shaft that passes power through the gas generator to the drive system input gears. And this is how it's possible to start a helicopter engine without turning the rotors. What happens is the gas generator section starts and operates at idle speed, while the exhaust gas that would normally turn the power section just blows past the stationary power turbine blades. This is what you're seeing on the screen. The gas generator sections are turning, while the power section and the rest of the drive system is stationary. Of course, the power turbine wants to turn because of the flow of exhaust gas, but the rotor brake prevents this from happening. I don't have the brake animated, and maybe I'll add that for a future video. A rotor brake looks surprisingly like a disc brake assembly on a car, and it's normally mounted on the tail rotor drive shaft. But all of the gears in the helicopter are part of the same drive system, so the rotor brake could theoretically be mounted anywhere in this system, and it would still prevent the rotors from turning. Now we'll talk about how the helicopter allows for an engine failure in flight. I think this question comes from the observation that the input gear shown in the animation doesn't have a visually apparent way to disconnect a failed engine from the drive system. The answer is the device I have highlighted. This is called a freewheeling unit, and its purpose is to disengage one or both engines from the drive system following an engine failure. Like airplanes, helicopters have the capability to glide. Maybe not as well, but gliding in a helicopter is possible, and it's called autorotation. And that term is used because the relative wind comes up through the bottom of the rotor when it's in a power-off descent, and this relative wind causes the rotor to rotate without engine power. It's this rotation that slows the rate of descent and allows a safe landing after failure of one or both engines. But safe autorotation requires minimal rotating friction in the drive system, and the drag on a non-operating engine is the most significant contribution to rotating friction. Remember, the power section of the engine is directly connected to the drive system, and it turns at 21,000 RPM. The power to sustain rotation of unpowered turbines at this high of an RPM would be such that it would prevent autorotation if those high RPM components were not disconnected from the drive system. And this disconnection is the purpose of the freewheeling unit. Let's zoom in on the detail of a freewheeling unit and see how it works. The freewheeling unit is alternately called a sprag clutch and sometimes an overrunning clutch, and this device is not unique to helicopters. Bicycles are very common applications for freewheeling units. Unless you're riding a direct drive bike, such as a toddler's tricycle or a fixie bike, you can pedal a bicycle, but if you stop pedaling, the bicycle doesn't pedal your legs. The pedals are allowed to stop rotating, even though the wheels still rotate. And this is because bicycles are equipped with freewheeling units, much like helicopters are. Inside the freewheeling unit are these things called sprags, and the sprags have a very unique geometry. The red arrow in the animation shows the distance between the driving shaft and the driven shaft, and the sprag has two key dimensions. Blue is greater than red, and green is less than red. This geometry means when the sprags rotate opposite the direction of drive, they allow the two shafts to turn independently. But when the sprags rotate in the direction of drive, the two shafts are locked together by the friction of the sprags. The sprags essentially wedge themselves into position, and this wedging force connects the two drive shafts together. In the case that I have animated on the screen, the outer shaft is the driving shaft, and the inner shaft is the driven shaft. The outer shaft is connected to the engine, and the inner shaft is connected to the rest of the drive system. Here is the normal mode of operation. The engine turns the outer shaft counterclockwise. This forces the sprags, assisted by this energizer spring, into the wedge position, which then transmits the power to the inner drive shaft. Here is the overrunning mode of operation. The inner shaft turns counterclockwise at a faster RPM than the outer shaft. This allows friction to overcome the wedged position of the sprags. They rotate out of that wedge position, which allows the inner and outer shafts to rotate independently. In the animation, the outer shaft is completely stopped, and this is the configuration of an auto-rotating helicopter. The freewheeling unit could be configured either way, with the inner shaft or the outer shaft as the driving shaft, but outer shaft drive is more reliable. It's less prone to slipping than inner shaft drive. Clutch slip in a helicopter is bad. The slip itself isn't any more hazardous than an engine failure, but a sudden re-engagement of a slipped clutch can cause parts to break in a way that can lead to loss of the aircraft. A clutch slip with a subsequent hard re-engagement is very often a catastrophic failure in a helicopter. Now I'll go back to that model of the entire helicopter and show the animation during autorotation. With both engines stopped, the freewheeling unit automatically switches to the overrunning position and allows the input gears and input pinions to come to a stop. The power turbines are directly connected to the input pinions, so they also come to a stop. Looking inside the freewheeling unit, you can see the sprags are rotated out of the wedged position to allow overrunning. And we also see the highest RPM gears, the input pinion and the input gear, they're stopped also. This reduces the friction in the system enough to allow unpowered, autorotative flight of the helicopter. Now I'll talk about some of the computer-aided design considerations I used in creating this model. Today I'm going to talk about how I came up with the sizing and the dimensions of the swash plates and the rotor controls. The design goal here was pretty simple. I needed to move the blades through an appropriate feathering angle for flight within the space constraints of the swash plates. I did a previous video on helicopter swash plate control, so I won't go into a huge amount of detail here. In short, the non-rotating swash plate transfers heave and tilt to the rotating swash plate, and this motion controls the helicopter. A key part of this design is this thing called the spherical bearing, and the spherical bearing allows for both tilt and vertical heave. I designed the blades to move through a feathering angle from negative 3 degrees to about 30 degrees. Collective pitch is responsible for a range from negative 3 to 15 degrees, and the remaining 15 degrees of feathering will be the allowance for cyclic pitch change. The spherical bearing rides up and down on a part called the swash plate guide, and I made the swash plate guide 200 millimeters tall, about 7.8 inches, and I gave the spherical bearing 65 millimeters of travel in order to get the 18 degrees of collective pitch change. The spherical bearing can also tilt plus or minus 6 degrees to allow for cyclic feathering. The next step in coming up with this design was to figure out, based on those limits of motion that I just talked about, the geometry of the pitch horn on the rotor blades in order to get the desired amount of feathering from this constrained motion of the spherical bearing. I could have come up with this sizing by doing the math. It's three-dimensional trigonometry, but for me it was just easier just to measure things, to use the CAD and to take measurements, and that's what I'm going to talk about here. First, I positioned the blade spindle at a neutral flapping angle, and then I adjusted the feathering angle to that maximum collective pitch angle, 15 degrees in this case. This turns out that's about mid-range for the combined collective and cyclic pitch change. Then I added a reference point for where the center of the upper pitch link is going to attach to the pitch horn. My next step was to project this geometry onto a horizontal plane and then use the CAD to take measurements. There was trial and error involved with this, and I basically just modified the sizing of the pitch horn until the motion of the spherical bearing gave me the total 30 degrees of feathering change that I was looking for. A remaining step for a future video is for me to add the pitch lengths into the design and then to animate the degrees of freedom, and that'll be the proof as to whether or not I got the math right. That technique I described earlier of taking measurements within the computer-aided design tools rather than trying to do the math ahead of time. It's one of the things I really like about the design and animation tools. It's much easier to conceptualize something if you can see it, hold it in your hand, and look at it from different angles to see how parts fit together and interact with one another. The software tools offer the next best thing to seeing how physical objects interact. And in some ways, it might even be better because they allow us to rapidly cycle through design choices in ways that were once only possible by building prototypes in a machine shop. There's only a few topics I want to talk about in the animation software today. I'm using Blender for the animation, so it's Autodesk Fusion for computer-aided design and Blender for the animation. I mentioned in that second video how organizing complex models into collections is very important to quickly move between different parts of the model. I want to add a little tip in Blender here that's very useful for doing this, and this is the selectable restriction toggle that's in the outliner. This allows you to turn on and turn off the ability to select entire collections. And I'm going to use this feature to very quickly duplicate the left-hand engine over to the right-hand side of the aircraft. And if you want this to show up in the outliner, you have to select it. It's not on by default. And you can select that by going up to the right-hand corner of the outliner and doing the drop-down. And then you're looking for this arrow as a restriction toggle. This is selectability of the different components. So turbine-powered multi-engine helicopters, the engines are generally the same part number between the left-hand and the right-hand side of the aircraft. They both rotate in the same direction, and it's possible to just swap one engine out from one side of the aircraft to the other. And that's exactly what I'm going to do in the animation tool here. I will copy the left-hand engine over to the right-hand side of the aircraft. So to do this, I'm going to make use of that selectability toggle. I'm going to turn every selection off except for the engine and the input pinion. And then to select all of the desired collections, all I have to do is hit the A key. The reason all of the other collections are not selected is because their selectability toggle is turned off. Once the engine and the input pinion are selected, I simply copy them by pressing Alt-D. And then because the helicopter is symmetrical, all I need to do to move them to the other side is to change the sign of the Y coordinate of the engine. And because I created a top-level parent for both of these collections, the engine and the input pinion, that's the only part that I need to move over to the other side. All of the children for that top-level parent follow it when I move it to the right-hand side of the aircraft. And because I applied all of the rotation controllers and drivers to the left-hand engine before I copied it, it was just that easy to have a rigged and working engine on the other side of the helicopter. I'll also point out that the new EV render engine in 4.2 is really nice. I used to spend a lot of time rendering animations for these videos. Now the viewport render seems good enough that I'm just screen capturing this. It certainly saves a lot of time making these videos. And that's all I have for this video. I thank you for watching. I also thank you for the comments you've posted to this channel. If you'd like to see more content like this, or if there are specific helicopter or tilt rotor subjects you'd like to see animated, please let me know. Liking and subscribing is an awesome way to encourage more content.